Come, let's pray. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are here with us. You are the author of this word. And we pray today that you will speak to us. You will sow seeds in our hearts. And they will bear rich harvest. In Jesus' name, Amen. So today is a double celebration, because December 17th, 2 years ago, was when Highway began. And so today is an anniversary, second year anniversary celebration. It's also a Christmas celebration. And so, you know, when we're just wondering how to balance the two things. And I think it's interesting that God gave me a message that both applies to our anniversary, because they are themes which have been constant throughout these past 2 years. And at the same time, it's from the Christmas story. And you can see that it's Luke 2, 8 to 20. I won't read verse 19, but 8 to 20. This is the third Sunday of Advent, December 1st, and then 8th and 15th. And it is so interesting that we've actually had the exact same passage. So it was Anne who did the sermon on the 1st, and then there was this video sermon that we used on the 8th. And obviously I would not have... Vedant, I think you shift from there because you will block everybody coming. Yeah?
I should shift there.
Even Akshay should shift actually. See, Vinod left his spot, no? His watchman's spot he left, so then... Yeah. So... It's as if God is not shifting us from this particular passage, though there are of course different Christmas stories that we could have used. So two themes that have come again and again through these past 2 years have been, one, the theme of presence and of seeking God's presence, and of God's presence being central to all that we do as a church. And the second theme has been that whatever we do will come from overflow, not from planning and academic stuff and all that, but from the overflow of being in God's presence. And I'd like to share something today from the Christmas story, where again and again this theme seems to come up of being in God's presence and allowing it to overflow. So Luke chapter 2 verses 8 to 9. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And the angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. So this angel appears to the shepherds, and it says, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. Where did this glory come from? It strikes me that the angel brought the glory with him. Yeah? The angel of the Lord is in the presence of the Lord, and he carries the glory of the Lord with him when he comes to the shepherds. We see this in Luke chapter 1 verse 19, where Gabriel is talking to Zechariah, and Zechariah doesn't believe him. And then Gabriel said, I am Gabriel, I stand in the presence of God. I can just imagine how terrifying that word must have been. That he is literally scolding Zechariah and saying that, how can you not believe? I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God. And so we know that angels are in the very presence of God. And this angel comes out of the presence of God to the shepherds, and the glory of the Lord comes with him. The angel carries God's glory. There's such a close connection between God's presence and God's glory. For example, Moses in Exodus, when he comes down from the mountain, his face is shining so much, it's so radiant, that people are scared to look upon his face. Now, how did his face get radiant? We know the Bible says that he was not just in God's presence, he was face to face with God. And the New Testament, we are told that's possible for all of us. We with unveiled faces reflect the Lord's glory. That means we are face to face with God, and you can only reflect what is in front of you. As we are in God's presence, we reflect His glory, we carry His glory where we go. There is absolutely no substitute for being in God's presence. And the amazing thing from the story of the angel is that being in God's presence overflows in carrying His glory. That's the first thing we can learn from these angels. That if you are in the presence of the Lord, glory will overflow in your life, around you, touching other people. We have this incredible privilege that once upon a time only Moses had of being face to face with God, reflecting His glory. And of course, this Christmas season can be so busy and so hectic that we do everything but spend time in God's presence. But here's a wonderful promise. We spend time in His presence and we will get to carry His glory. I can't think of anybody who knows Jesus who would not want to carry His glory, be a carrier of His glory. But that comes out of spending time in His presence. We move on to verses 10 to 12. So they were terrified, but the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." So the angel brings God's glory with him from the Lord's presence. He also brings good news. I bring good news. As we spend time in the Lord's presence, we will bring good news out of His presence. That's what the angel does. He brings the good news that the Messiah, the Savior, the Lord has been born to you. He says it's good news for all people. There's a revelation of the Son of God who has come down to earth. The song that we just sang, "Love Came Down." All of this has come out of God's presence. Again, I think of Moses. Moses encounters God in the burning bush. And what does he come away from that with? The good news that the people are now going to be set free. That God has seen their struggle, God has seen their... He has heard their prayers. And finally, He is going to act on their behalf. Now, good news for the Israelites was bad news for Pharaoh, because the message was, "Let my people go." So good news for you and me is also bad news for Satan. But that's okay. Now the angel actually doesn't tell the shepherds to go and look for Jesus. But he says this will be a sign to you. It's as if there's an invitation to do so. It's an invitation for them to experience or explore or encounter further. But the angel's job is to come and bring the good news. And so out of the presence of the Lord comes the good news, the revelation of the Messiah, the Christ, the Savior, the Lord. So that's the second thing. You know, we know that the season is one of good news. We sing the song, we know the story. "I bring you good news of great joy for all people." And somehow we are not able to communicate that good news. Something is missing. What is missing is not the words. What is missing is not the theology. What is missing is the presence. Time spent in His presence. Because His good news will be so specific for different people. We don't have good news to give because we haven't spent time in His presence. So that's the second thing that comes out of the presence. There's an overflow of good news for people. Then 13 to 14, suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom His favor rests. You know, I'm just speculating, but it's almost as if this whole company of angels couldn't help coming. There's nowhere in the Bible that we have more than one or two angels coming and with a specific message. This is a very unique circumstance here, where we have a whole company or choir of angels and they're just bursting into song and praising God. It's almost as if they cannot contain themselves. Something so amazing is happening, something so exciting is happening, and as I thought about it, I said, Christmas kit is in my head, something that we can do someday. But that sense of this is such good news, they cannot help but start praising. In effect, this is the first Christmas carol. By the way, I don't know what they were singing, because it said they were praising God and singing. So whether they were singing these two lines, or they were singing something else and then they said these two lines, we don't know. But it seems to be that at this point was the first Christmas carol. And it's interesting that out of all our festivals, really it is the Christmas season that is where worship is so traditional, where it's become such a integral part of our festivity to have these Christmas carols. I think it comes from this place that even the angels could not help themselves bursting out in song. Out of God's presence comes an outburst of praise. But it's more than praise. When I looked at the words, glory to God in the highest heaven, it's actually a blessing. It reminds me of the line in the Lord's Prayer, hallowed be your name. Okay. It is a blessing towards God, glory to God in the highest heaven, and there's a blessing released towards earth, and on earth peace to those on whom His favor rests. It's actually a blessing. So as you are in God's presence, not only will you burst with praise, because God is so awesome. Look at this amazing thing that He is doing. The Messiah is born. That's in that situation. In our situation, it will be different things. But we burst out in praise. But we also get an understanding of God's heart. Why did Jesus come? He came to release peace. And so the angels also release a blessing. And on earth, peace to those on whom His favor rests. It comes from them knowing God's heart and then releasing that blessing. And the same is true for you and me. As we spend time in God's presence, we will overflow with praise, but we will also overflow with blessing. As we recognize what is on God's heart for the people around us, blessing will be released. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. As I said before, the angel didn't really say go leave your flocks and go and find the baby. The angel just, the good news released an invitation which they had to respond to. And so that encounter was an invitation, and it burst in the shepherds a desire. And that desire overflowed in action. In something that was an act of the will, it was intentional, it overflowed the action of seeking Him. And you know, the Christmas story has become so familiar to us that I don't think we seek Jesus in this season, because we know everything. Today, just once again, I went over Luke chapter 1 and 2, and all the words are so familiar. And yet, the good news is an invitation for us to seek Him afresh, to go deeper. Again, as I said, it's been 2 years, and the most familiar prayer in these 2 years have been, "More Lord, more of You." And when we can't say more, Lord, it's been, "Give us more hunger, give us more thirst, give us more desperation, give us more desire." that we may want more of you. And really here is the invitation to seek Jesus. And that's what the shepherds do. It said they hurried off, so there was a sense of urgency. They left the field. There was a separation. They were set apart, and they went in. You know, they had to leave their routine. They had to leave what was comfortable, and they had to go and seek Jesus. And so out of God's presence, the angels came, carrying God's glory, bringing good news, bursting in praise and releasing blessing. And all of that released this desire in the shepherds. Let's go and do this. Let's go and see if it's true. And they hurried off. It overflowed into action. And finally, when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. The angels came out of God's presence, and now the shepherds entered into the presence of the Son of God. As they go to the manger, they are in God's presence. And out of that presence, what flows is testimony. Testimony and witness flows out of being in the presence of the Christ child. Again, it is as if they cannot contain the good news. It says they went everywhere. We are told that it's a night, so we are not sure what kind of a ruckus they created in the night in that little village of Bethlehem. Going around telling everybody what they had heard and what they had seen. And that is so important. It's what they had heard, which is what the angels said, but also what they had seen. So much of our testimony falls flat because it's just what we've heard. You know, in Matthew chapter 5, when Jesus is in the Sermon on the Mount, he keeps on saying, you've heard this, but I tell you, what's the point of making? Your knowledge is secondhand. You haven't experienced for yourself. But the shepherds had both heard, and because they went and sought, they had also seen. And out of that presence came this testimony. Our sharing has to spring out of revelation as well as out of a seeking. Now, just as the angels shared something with the shepherds, and that was an invitation for them to seek, what the shepherds were sharing was also an invitation, right? They were telling people about what happened. They were talking to people in Bethlehem and around Bethlehem, which means anybody they spoke to could have also gone and seen for themselves. It tells us that people were amazed, that they marveled, that they wondered at what the shepherds were saying. You know, the text doesn't tell us that anybody went to see after that. I'd like to believe that some people must have gone, because we know that Mary and Joseph and Jesus were in Bethlehem for at least 2 more years. I'm hoping people went and saw, but we don't know that. And the question is, how did they respond? Out of being in God's presence, the shepherds testified. They witnessed. They were excited. People marveled and wondered, but we don't know if they responded. And this Christmas story is an invitation to experience Jesus afresh. But it's an invitation that is filled with the promise of overflow. That as we seek Jesus afresh, as we enter deeper into his presence, we will carry his glory. We will bring good news. We will burst out in praise, and we will release blessing, because we're getting a sense of God's heart. There will be this desire for more of Jesus. where it can design them here. And there will be an uncontainable testimony that is coming from a direct experience of Jesus. So it's an amazing season, and the question is the same: how will we respond? Let's seek God afresh in this season, and let that revelation and let that experience overflow to those around us. You know, as we do that, we will actually be inviting our families, our friends, our colleagues, and maybe even strangers into this good news of great joy. It's up to them to respond or not, but it's up to us to carry His glory. It's up to us to bring good news. And as we've just seen, we really can't do any of this ourselves. We can only do it if we are overflowing. We can only do it with His help. The good news is not just that Jesus came 2,000 years ago. The even better news is that He's still around by His Spirit. We get to encounter Him so much more deeply because He chooses to live in us by His Spirit. And really today, I'd like us to invite the Holy Spirit to come afresh, to make this season special for us. He is the one who gives us the desire. He is the one who propels us into more of God's presence. That all of these things can then follow from that. So I'm just going to invite us to stand for a minute. Yeah. And I'd like to invite the Holy Spirit to come and fill us and equip us and empower us for this season. I don't want to go through another Christmas. It's just like the song we sang, no? They just sang that song. What did we sing? Nothing else? Just go through the motion, just sing another song. Just go through another Christmas, just have the festivities, have the decorations, the plum cake, and we haven't carried His glory, and we haven't brought good news, and we haven't sought Him. Okay. Come, let's close our eyes. Say, come Holy Spirit. We really can't do this without You. Lord, we want to seek You afresh in this season. Lord, we want to experience You afresh. We want to encounter You afresh. We say we need a fresh filling. We need a fresh revelation, Lord. We want to be carriers of Your glory and drinkers of good news. We want to overflow in praise and blessing and testimony, Lord. We want to be a people who are hungry and thirsty for You. We are willing to set aside, Lord, in order to seek You. We can't do any of this without Your Holy Spirit. So right now we say, come and fill us afresh. Thank You that You are here. We pray now, Lord, for heart and hearts to be softened. For hearts that are discouraged, cynical. To be softened by Your Spirit. If you want to be filled to overflowing, or we want to leave hold of your promise, of your Spirit coming like streams of living water flowing out of us. And let that be true for us at this season, Lord. Even today, Lord, even this morning, we've been in your presence. Let there be overflow. In your name we pray.